This is fight 248, and this is the, oh man, Anusarn Market Stadium in Chiang Mai, which I had never fought at. I fought there 2 days before against Pommy, and I'm fighting against Nong Hong, who I reckoned going into this fight that this was the eighth time that we'd fought, and then I changed that to be maybe it was six, and it turns out this is seven. So I fought her, including this, seven times. I haven't fought her in a long time, and when I saw her, I was like, my god, Nong Hong has gotten much bigger. But interesting thing about Anusarn Market is that it's the same promoter who I used to fight for a lot when I was up in Chiang Mai at the Kalea Stadium, and then they just kind of moved it not too far away. So this is kind of the second time I'm fighting at this stadium in a really, really long time, but kind of like the billionth time I'm fighting at this stadium, because it's basically the same as it was when I was up in Chiang Mai. But fight 247 had been 2 days earlier at the same stadium, and I'd lost to Pommy, who I've fought now six times. That was our sixth fight. And it was a very disappointing loss for me. I was pissed at the way that I'd fought, or not fought, really. And so I kind of had a day to get my mental shit together to come back into this fight and make corrections and all of the things that I should have done in the Pommy fight. Pommy and Nong Hong are not that similar of fighters, but they are very similar in that they style a great deal. So part of my mistake in the Pommy fight was allowing her kind of space and energy to do that styling. So I felt like I really needed to kind of close in and be more aggressive and really fight from the start of this bell in this fight. This is my third fight in 7 days. So I fought in Hua Hin, then came up to Chiang Mai and had two fights 2 days apart. And this is the last in that string of three. I was pretty sore. I had clinched with Tonadet on my off day between these two fights. And that's really good for me in terms of just getting that kind of practice in. He's absolutely stellar in clinching altogether, but then he's like this master of the long clinch, which I'm really trying to bring into my arsenal. And so I always like to work with him when I can, when I'm in Chiang Mai. And being sore from fighting Pommy, who's much bigger than me, and then clinching with Tonadet on my day off, and then coming in and fighting Nong Hong, who I think is the biggest she's ever been when I fought her. They said 52 for this fight, and Kevin said 55 on the live stream, but she's probably 58. Her thighs are significantly bigger than they've been in the past. But people ask me, how do you fight so often? And the thing about it is, you're sore anyway. So like, you can be sore and stay home and not fight, or you can be sore and fight. And it's kind of like two birds, one stone for me. It doesn't have a great deal of effect in the fight. I don't lose flexibility, because once you get going, you have the same flexibility you would have. You just might have some like bruises, but I train with that all the time anyway, so for me it's not something that's restrictive in any way. But I have these new shorts from Woody Muay Thai. They gave me these shorts as fight shorts, and they have this like sequence on the like X's on the side there. So I like spray glitter all over the ring as that stuff flakes off, but Nong Hong's shorts are like so much more Vegas blinged out than mine. I don't know how, if she's never worn these before or what, how they stay so sparkly, but they're pretty incredible. I was also kind of stoked that my Ram Muay matched up with being able to stalk her into the corner. That doesn't happen all the time with her. She usually has quite a long Ram Muay. Mentally, I felt pretty good going into this. I don't love fighting Nong Hong. She beat me once by a cut stoppage. She cut me up in the forehead, and actually the cut was so deep it hit a vein or something, and I had to go get secondary stitches, like deeper stitches, after the doctor at the ring had stitched me. So I kind of have this like vengeance feeling, like I've always wanted to get her back. And other than that fight that was a cut stoppage leading up to this fight, I'd won all of the other fights, but I've never like hurt her in the way that, she's cut me. So I kind of had to like find in my head that I don't fight well when I'm like trying to be vengeful. So I was just trying to correct the mistakes from the night, the other night against Palmy. But I'm using this front side kick, which has been working well for me in my past, I don't know, maybe four or five fights. Oh, she's got big legs, man. One of the things I like about Neng Hong is that she's actually quite aggressive. Like, when she comes at you, she comes hard. She is not a, like, patty cake fighter. She wears a lot of makeup in the ring, which is her prerogative. She's into that. But it's kind of cool to have, like, a beautiful I-put-makeup-on fighter who's also aggressive and tries to cut me. I've been working on eye contact in training a lot, and it's starting to come into my fights, but just kind of in clips. Neng Hong is like the queen of eye contact. Because I wasn't making eye contact in this fight, I wasn't as aware of it, but looking at all the photos, the beautiful photos that Kevin has been putting up, oh, her eye contact is amazing. My crosses are coming out pretty well. They'd worked against Palmy as well, who's southpaw, and I was snapping Neng Hong's head back, which I don't think I've really hit her with punches in our previous fights, so that's a cool thing to be bringing in. She got me right there. I gave her a little nod. Oh, she's so much bigger than me. That was not good. When you catch a kick like that and can't work someone around, it works against you, because the kick actually counts. Like, it lands and it counts, and then you can't, like, dump someone or land a big score as well. You basically just got kicked and then looked like an idiot. So there's a risk to catching kicks, but that was a good throw on my part. These are early rounds, it's just round one, so even though we're definitely coming at each other and hitting each other for real, this doesn't matter so much until much later in the fight. But I'm happy that I started clinching in round one, because that was one of the problems I had against Palmy 2 days ago, is that I just kind of let it go too long. I started too late. You can look at me right now. I'm putting my hand on Palmy's back. I fought Palmy 2 days ago, and she's in my corner against Neng Hong. This makes me so happy. She's never cornered for me. We're friends on Facebook, but like, me and Palmy are not like friends. But she fought Neng Hong last week and lost to her. And so now she's in my corner, like, against Neng Hong. Just so, like, I geeked out more about Palmy being in my corner than, like, anything else about this fight. It was very cool. I was very excited. I've very, very few times in my life had women in my corner. So I liked it a lot. She and Dang seem very friendly. She actually seems very friendly with a lot of the trainers and kind of people around Chiang Mai. I think she's very personable in that group. I just don't like fighting her because she's difficult to fight. She's actually a very sweet girl. It was raining this day, and so at like 11 in the morning, Dang had contacted me and was like, "We're not sure if the fights are going to happen tonight." It's like trying to get my mental game together from my loss against Palmy 2 days ago, and then you get a call that's like the fight might not be happening, and you have to deal mentally with the uncertainty of whether it's happening or not, and the horror of like, maybe I kind of want it to not happen, and you have to like deal with that thought that you have that thought. But then by like 2 or 3 in the afternoon, he let me know that the fight was on for sure. So I just had to like get my space on. It was good. Now she's doing that forward kick. Stole it from me. Pinu works with me on that a lot, but my teep has been working really well in my last few fights as well. Because she's so big, when I block and I don't stand really hard, I kind of bounce off of the blocks, which makes it just less effective on my part. She has this thing where she like grinds her chin into my face when we're clinching. Here, I was like locking her low and she was bending back so hard that it looked like a back break on my part. But I actually wasn't pulling her lower body in, she was leaning back. And long guard's working much better. I wish I were staying a little bit closer. See how I overturn when I come in for that clinch? That makes me have to work an extra 2 or 3 moves and an extra 2 or 3 seconds to get to a dominant position, and she can smush my face like this on my overturn, and it makes it very hard for me to move. Now she's doing a low clinch, and we're kind of locked up here, but I'm still scoring and she's not. So I have to, like, I've had that overturn problem for a long time, and it's gotten significantly better, but it's one of these, like, habits that just takes a really long time to correct. I'm locking her right arm out really well. I mean, her left arm out. That was a good score on her part. And now she's just gonna, like, pop her knees to, like, try to look active. She's having a hard time, though. She's trying to keep my leg out with her arm, and that big sloping leg coming over scores, but my dump on her, I think, was good in that moment. She gets up really good. She's always, like, laughing when she gets up from being dumped, although she does not love it, for sure. That was a Nam Sok Noi, like, stutter step. So you, like, switch your stance and then throw your jab as a cross. That's worked for me pretty well in the past maybe four fights. I did a private with him for the Muay Thai library. As a patron, you can go look at that, where he teaches me that. And it just kind of felt really natural to me, so I ended up working on it in the gym a lot, and it's come into my fights really quickly. I never would have in a million years thought, like, Nam Sok Noi's style would feel really good to me, but it does. There are elements of Muay Thai fighting that feel really nice. You're never like one thing entirely, but definitely my heart is Muay Thai. And then there are like these little flavoring elements that you can put in just because they feel really good. That was something that Sakmon Khon said to me many, many years ago, is he said, train the things that you like because those are the ones that you're actually gonna use. Like if a move doesn't feel good to you, you're not gonna use it, especially under pressure. So here Dang is telling me to keep my hands up and to swim my arm in faster in the clinch. He saw me overturning and like taking too long to get into a better position to start scoring. I just need to get into a better position faster. And then he wants me to jerk her head down to kind of off balance her in order to start landing my knees better. But that was just round two. So again, not even scoring yet, but a lot of things happening. So I just have to keep climbing in that, and this is really how I should have been fighting Palmy 2 days ago, so I'm making the corrections immediately 2 days later in my next fight that were problems in the fight before. So fighting frequently is definitely good in those measures. Oh, she's coming now. Round three, she's coming hard. So she's trying to lock me a little bit low to like keep me from being able to lock her up top. And I'm actually having a hard time like moving around her head. She's got her chin in my shoulder really well. She's actually landing some pretty good scores here. Because of her size, she really just has to put her weight on me when we're against the ropes like that. So I should be pulling her off the ropes. There's a nice elbow from her part. She's had success elbowing me in the past, so I always know that she's gonna be throwing elbows at me. This is the first fight where I really threw them back at her enough to piss her off. That was a nice time on her part. She timed that knee and plopped me down, but I got up first, which is why she's making that face. She's doing this thing. She's like trying to pull the outside of my guard, which is actually really cool. Her elbows in clinch. There's another nice timed turn on her part. I didn't realize we went down twice in that round. Her elbows right there, that was a beautiful elbow, the timing on it. I don't know how she trains that, like in the clinch, throwing those elbows or like the timing of people coming in. I don't know if she does that in pad work or if she feints them in sparring or if it's just from fighting. She's really good at it though. There's an elbow from me, that made me happy. And here I'm starting to get straight knees. These are really high scoring. She's just trying to like stagnate it and her head went out the side of the ropes to have the ref come save us. Here I'm circling left a little bit, which is what Kevin's always yelling at me. This is good as I'm like kind of stuck on the porch a little bit, which was a problem 2 days ago. So to kind of like circle in to close that distance is good. Oh, that drag down and stand over. That's the Sylvie special. There have been a few fights between me and Nang Hong. That was a beautiful elbow. That gave me a huge welt under my eye. That was started actually two fights ago at the beginning of this three fight stream. So two girls helped make that black eye. Oh, those are really big scores, and then her head goes out the rope. So, exciting round three from both of us. Definitely my round, but she put me down twice with really nice timed turns in the clinch, which is brilliant from her. Again, this is our seventh fight together, so she kind of knows what I have, and I kind of know what she has, but both of us have leveled up in the time since the last time we fought. But those, like, timing on the turns, I feel is new from her, which is cool. Standing down there on the right is what we call Little Nung. He's not little anymore, but when I first met him, he was like 14 and he was tiny up at Lana Muay Thai. So I've known him for like 9 years. And he goes and trains people in China for like 6 months at a time. And he was back, so it was pretty cool having Little Nung at my fight as well. I haven't seen him in quite a while. Again, Dang telling me that I need to be faster at swimming my arms in and then to push her face to land my knees. When you push an opponent's face not to get out of the clinch, but to like break their posture so that your knees can come, it's basically like you're taking a lot of their power out, but you're also distorting their posture and their frame so that when you land things, they're kind of in a super vulnerable, not easy to protect themselves position. Whereas if you're defensively smushing the face, which is what Nang Hong is doing to me, you're basically trying to keep someone from locking you. And she's actually not able to land strikes out of that position from a defensive point as well as I'm able to land them from an offensive point by just breaking her posture. Oh, there's the teep. Kevin's always so happy when I teep in fights. My teep came from Krunu almost 100% the first year that we moved down to Petchrungruang. He never taught me the teep, he just would make me teep nonstop in the last round of pads all the time. That was a little bit of a plow right there, but it looked good. And so I've developed this teep under pressure, and I kind of like don't think to do it, but it starts to come out under pressure and it's really effective. So when I start thinking to do it as part of my arsenal, I think it'll be really good. It's another nice elbow from her from that like overturned position. I need to wrench my shoulder back. That's a point right there. That like huge wide knee landing on my back. That was her moment. It's a nice elbow. It didn't land, but it looked mean. She's fouling right there. And I was able to like turn her on that, turn her on the foul. So I ended up getting a much bigger point. But again, what I'm saying, when I block, just because of our size difference, when I'm bouncing off of my block, I need to have like much more solidity in the like bam that didn't move me. It's hard when people outweigh you by like 20 pounds. I like that move. I've been doing it a lot where I like pad the jab down and cross over it. Sagat showed me something like that in our most recent library session, which just went up. So if you're a patron, go look at that. I really like this move and it lands really well, but I really want to like straighten out my cross more. Oh, that's my moment of humiliating Nang Hong instead of being able to like cut her or hurt her. I guess. That was nice. The ref didn't break that. I kind of thought he was coming in to stop it, but he stopped himself because of the action. That's a good referee. Still overturning, but like trying to wrench my left arm back a little bit. It's one of these things where like under pressure, you go back to kind of states that you have to build over habits. You can't just like pave over a road and expect the roots to not come up under it. You have roots under it. So you really have to like work to change these things. And then under pressure or fatigue, you'll kind of roll way back and have these habits come forward that you had many years ago. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you're regressing, but it's kind of like these old scars show through or something. And it just takes a lot of time to like work over those foundations. So this overturning problem is something that when I really, really focus on it, it gets better for like a, you know, stretch of 4 or 5 months. And then I'll start working on something else and kind of forget. And like these old habits will come in under the pressure. So it's a matter of like really establishing everything that you want to have change under pressure. Like you can't just change it in the gym and expect it to work in fights. You have to change it in the gym under pressure so that you do it under pressure. And that's one of the harder things about being a fighter, is that some things take a really, really long time to change. And mentally it can be really frustrating, especially like my fight against Palmy 2 days ago. I felt like I'd taken like massive steps backwards. But it's not like that. It's kind of like a ghost from the past making an appearance rather than you having time traveled backwards or something like that. Last round, the forced hug. She's in good shape, but she's definitely more tired than I am at this point. That block is what I'm talking about. See how she like bounced off of me instead of me bouncing off of her? And it kind of like came up without it looking like I was making a lot of effort. I was sparring with Krunu yesterday, and he was really putting it on me. He's much bigger than anyone I fight. And I could feel how I like crunch when I'm trying to block, when I'm tired and under pressure like that. And so I've made it a point to kind of like work on my posture when I'm blocking rather than the block itself, like just the posture. And that's something that I've talked about maybe in these last voiceovers for the last couple of fights, is the root Muay, which is like your general composure, like the overall picture of you as a fighter. Hers is really nice and I have to work to break it. I break my own when I like crunch to block because I look scared or something. Here we've already touched gloves, like she's seceded that I won this fight, but she's gonna come after me anyway. She's not throwing with full power anymore, but she actually decides to go at this second here. Like, she kind of seceded and then was like, no, I'm actually gonna come in and try to slam you. But I got her in this position. And because I was already winning, the ref is breaking it fast, not to like screw me over, but is breaking it fast because this is already done. So I got to have like a 10-second dance off at the last bit of the fight, which is good. I've said in previous voiceovers that sometimes I dance off too early, even though I already am winning. For my style of fighting, it really just, if you do it at all, needs to be like the last 10 seconds of a fight or something. So I totally like redeemed myself from my fight 2 days ago in terms of like how I should have fought. I have this huge, huge like mouse under my eye. I thought I looked like Cruella De Vil, how she has those like upturned super sharp cheekbones after the fight. There's Palmy helping me in the corner. Very, very nice of her to come out and help. They had a couple of fighters on the card, so she was there anyway, but she did not have to help in my corner. That was totally cool of her to do. It's always hard to find the like start of the tape. It's like the hardest part after a fight of taking things off is finding the start of the tape. I'm trying to hand Kevin my mouthpiece and he's like, I have 9 cameras and 4 devices. Like, why are you trying to hand things to me? This is very typical of like stadia in Thailand, is basically just like sheet metal around an area to keep it cut off so that they can sell tickets, and then just like plastic chairs and a ring. It's very minimal, but I don't know, it's very Thai and it's cool. I like that a stadium is just this thing that you can set up and have Muay Thai happen there. It's not like a big hubbub kind of thing. This guy's very sweet. He came out to see me on Wednesday and said he was too shy to come say hi. So I told him to come again on Friday and definitely come say hi. He's training up in Chiang Mai. So he and his girlfriend came out to see me twice, which was very, very nice. If you guys ever come to one of my fights, I always really appreciate when people come to help support at my fights. Please come say hello. I am not someone who like has to be in a zone before my fights, and even if I lose and I'm feeling shitty, I'm not like unapproachable after a fight. Please come say hello. I may not be able to like stay in chat forever, but I always like to say hi to people, and I really appreciate people coming out to support, and being able to say thank you and meet people is nice. There's P-Boy from the Thai Claw Shop, who has been making my shorts since forever. He is who you should get your custom shorts from in Chiang Mai. 100% his shop is down by the Calais Night Bazaar. He's very nice. All these people were waiting to take photos with me, so I basically have to stand in front of this poster and people like switch in and out to take the photo. I've been told by people that I look exactly the same in every single photo when people are switching out like this. I kind of don't know how to like change my pose, like it's the same pose, right? So, it's nice though, I like that people get excited by watching the fight and want photos after. It makes me feel very good. You can see the rain on the ground. I think it had like stopped raining maybe halfway through the show or something. I don't know how to pose other than with my fists up. Like if I'm at someone's wedding or something, I'm gonna pose like this. I have no other way of standing in photos anymore. It's, I think, something that a lot of fighters can relate to. It's like the only way to pose. These little Thai girls came up to take a photo. I loved them. This little one got her photo taken by the bigger one. Oh, she's so cute. And then we got a photo with both of them afterwards. They hung around a little bit. I'm really glad I got a photo with both of them. They're so cute. I love when little girls, I don't know what they see in me, but when they're excited by whatever they see in me as a fighter, I get so stoked for little girls to be into that. I think we're having a chat about which states we come from. That guy's from the U.S. Celebrity status. Get all the photos. I was definitely feeling much better after this fight than my last one, which the win will do. But I performed much better. And I was basically just waiting to get my wraps off and put something on my face to start getting the swelling down a little bit. I used ice for one day and then I used heat after that and it went away really, really fast. So people have asked me if I ice things. Generally, I don't. But because of the lump on that, I iced it the first day. I don't ice my shins or anything. Saying thank you to my patrons and my sponsors and pointing out my Onyx MMA sponsor shirt. It's my new fight top. My work in progress black eye showing up right there. And then the little girls were coming back, so that's who I'm looking at over on the side there. I was like, we have to get a photo with them. They're so cute.
This is just after fight 248. I fought Nang Hong, who Deng asked me before the fight how many times I fought her, and I said 8, and he balked, which I think it just feels like 8. I think I actually haven't fought her 8 times.
Maybe 6 times.
It might be 6. Go left, left. Towards Taipei.
Okay.
Okay, so this is the same stadium I fought at 2 days ago against Balmy. Balmy was in my corner! How cool is that? I can tell you the number of times I've had women in my corner is very, very few. And to have your opponent that you had on Wednesday in your corner on Friday is awesome. And I actually was really excited. I think that's my favorite part of this fight, even though lots of other amazing things happen. Nang Hong is enormous, and she throws good elbows. She clipped me with like 3 of them, so you guys can see the one near my eye. She got me in the nose, which is bleeding internally, and she got me in my teeth, so that's fun. I went, like, I actually derned in this fight, which I didn't do on Wednesday.
What is dern?
Dern is to go forward, to be the advancing fighter. Does not mean to be aggressive, it means to be the, like, one pulling the action. In Thai, they have this very cool phrase. It means to start the game. You open the game.
What's
they call
the phrase?
It Burt game.
Ah.
I like it. I first heard Yod Kwon Pon say it, and so I always associate it with him, even though tons of people use it.
It's like playing white in chess.
It's like something. My attitude is better after this fight because I won, but I also did the things in this fight that I should have done in my last fight in order to be able to win. So the cool thing about fighting back-to-back like that is that you can make immediate, like, test kitchen-type corrections where, like, we watch MasterChef, and they always do, like, a test cook. So it's like you cook the meat and it tastes like crap. Don't cook it that way again. Like, change it a little bit. So that's what I was able to do. So now I'm not the one feeling shitty. Nang Hong gets to go home feeling shitty. Sorry about that. But I'm happy with what I did. Yeah.
You're asking me if you're happy?
Yeah. Kevin's happy with what I did.
I think you're happy. That was a very exciting fight.
So 248 win.
You had to dig down.
I had to dig down. I got a little tired, which is really, really good because yesterday was my day off between fights, and I went and clinched with Tonadette. I can't believe that was yesterday. It feels like a really long time ago.
It does feel like a week ago.
And I didn't do any of those things in the fight, but the, like, just keep moving kind of thing, I think was there, because I was overturning a lot and putting myself in a bad position that she was able to hold me in, because she knows what to do, and being able to not be like, oh, I'm in a bad position, I can't do anything. I just kept moving. got to better positions. So, hooray. Thank you, Dang, for cornering for me. Thank you, Palmy, for cornering for me. I got to see Little Nung. Little Nung's not little, but he was like 14 when I first went to Lana back in 2010. And so I've known him for a long time, 9 years. Mm. He's enormous now. And
enormous, like a muscular.
Like hulking, like,
yeah.
Like, he could be played by Tom Hardy in a movie. It's really big. but we're headed home now. I need to get some ice for my face. So thank you guys for watching live, those of you who watch live. If you guys are watching this on YouTube after with my voiceover and this part's at the end, I live stream my videos, or Kevin does. So you can watch these live when they happen if you follow my Facebook page. And those of you who are watching this on my Facebook page, my voiceover goes up on YouTube a while after my fights. Not too long, usually.
A week or two after.
My last two are done, so we'll put Wednesdays up really soon, and then this one will be up. Kevin hates when I talk about temporal things, because they don't matter by the time people see them.
2 years from now, people are like, yeah, what, huh? It's like, more Joe Rogan ads, please.
These high-fastening jeans will be timeless. Okay. Thanks, guys.